Welcome to this eLearn Security video training lesson on Burp Suite. Burp Suite is an integrated platform for performing security testing of web applications. It is composed of many tools that can help in the entire testing process, from initial mapping and analysis of the web application attack surface, through to finding and exploiting security vulnerabilities. During this video, we will see the most important features that Burp Suite offers, such as the proxy, the crawler, the spider, and the repeater. Kali Linux already has Burp Suite installed. In order to get started, we can just click on Application, Kali Linux, Web Application, Web Application Fuzzers, and then click on Burp Suite. Note that we can also run Burp Suite by opening a new terminal and running the Burp Suite command. This will open the main window of Burp Suite. As we can see in here, we have different tabs for each tool that Burp Suite offers. The Target tool gives you an overview of your target application's content and functionality. It contains two tabs, Sitemap and Scope. The first one contains detailed information about our target application. Of course, right now it's empty, since we didn't specify any target or run any test. The latter tab helps us define the scope of our tests. The Burp proxy lets us intercept, view, and modify all of the requests and the responses passing between our browser and our target application. We will soon see how to configure the proxy on our local machine in order to intercept the traffic. Burp Spider is a tool that will help us to automatically crawl the target web application. This is very useful if we do not know the target application and we want to get an idea of how it is composed. The last tool we are going to see in this video is the repeater. This simple tool allows us to manually manipulate and reissue HTTP requests in order to analyze the application's responses. This may come in handy if we want to request the same page multiple times, but with different parameters, and see how the application responds. So now that we have an overview of the tool and its components, let us start configuring it. The first thing to do when using Burp Suite is to reset its configurations. Since Burp stores the configuration set in previous sessions, it is very useful to clean the environment if we are going to run tests on new target applications. To do so, we can simply click on Burp, Restore Defaults, and then select All Options. So let's confirm it and start a new clean environment. Great, now we're good to go. The first tool we want to configure is the proxy. As said before, this will allow Burp to intercept and inspect all the requests and the responses of our browser, and reuse them for our analysis. So let's click on the sub-tab options and configure the proxy listener. By default, Burp creates a listener on our loopback address on port 8080. This configuration is good for our purposes, but let's see what other options we can edit. As we can see here, we can change the port as well as the interface on which the listener will be bound. We can set it on loopback only, all interfaces, or a specific network interface. For our test, the loopback only is enough. In the Request Handling tab, we can set how to control whether Burp redirects requests received by this listener. For now, we do not need to set any of these options. The last tab, Certificate, allows us to configure the server SSL certificate that is presented to SSL clients. For now, let's use the default settings and ignore these configurations. So our proxy listener should be okay. Let's click OK to confirm. Note that we can enable and disable the listener by simply checking or unchecking the box here. Moreover, let's scroll down a bit in this page and let us check the following box. This option instructs Burp to intercept the responses too. The next step is to configure our web browser proxy in order to instruct it to go through Burp. To do so, let's open our web browser and open the preferences. In the Advanced tab, let's select the Network sub-tab and click on Settings. As we can see here, we do not have a proxy configured yet. Let's select the Manual Proxy Configuration and set the same parameters typed in Burp. So we will type here the loopback address, which is 127.0.0.1, and the port 8080, and then confirm. Now we should be good to go and start our tests. Let's go back and verify that everything is okay with Burp. So here the proxy is enabled. Let's move in the Intercept tab and be sure that the button Intercept is on is enabled too. When enabled, Burp will display every request and response in order to allow us to inspect it and eventually forward or drop it. So let's request a page from our web browser and see what happens. Our target application is hosted at the following address, targetapplication.site. As we can see, we requested the page, but it is not displayed on the browser. This happens because Burp intercepted the request. Indeed, if we need to go back in the Burp Intercept tab, we can see the request sent to targetapplication.site, requesting the index.html resource. Now we can choose an action to perform. We can forward the request, we can drop it, but we can also perform a few more operations by clicking on the Action button. For example, we can tell Burp to send the request to other Burp tools, such as the spider, the intruder, and so on, or simply copy the URL, save the request, and much more. For now, let's forward the request and see what happens. As we can see, as soon as we hit forward, Burp intercepts the response sent by the server. Here again, we can see the whole content of the response, and we can choose what to do. Once again, let's forward it and continue. Now we will see many responses coming from the web server. This is because it is sending other files such as CSS files, JavaScript files, and so on. So let's turn the intercept off and go back to the browser. Here we are. The page loads successfully. Note that we can also modify the request before it is sent to the server. For example, let us try to request the login page once again and then change the content of the request. First, let's enable the intercept. Here, the request has been intercepted. Let us try now to change the page request and set it to test.html. As we can see, even in the address bar, we have index.html. We requested the test.html page. Now that we know Burp is working properly, let's move on and inspect the target tab. As we can see, the panel on the left starts populating with our requests and responses. From here, we can browse these three by expanding each object. Once we click on it, the right panel gets populated with all of the requests and responses performed to that address. Before inspecting these communications, it is very important to set the scope of our tests. Defining it will avoid us intercepting and displaying requests and responses that are outside our target scope. We can do it in many different ways. For example, we can right-click on the item in the list and select Add to Scope. If we now open the Scope tab, we can see that it's been added. This rule simply tells Burp to consider only the communication to and from this address. Note that we can add the scope in a few other ways. The simplest one is to copy the address from our browser URL bar and click on Paste URL. First, let's delete this rule and copy it from our browser. Now, let's just click Paste URL, and the rule will be automatically added. Now that we've defined our scope rules, let's go back into the Sitemap tab and set it to display only the item defined in scope. We can do it by simply clicking on the filter notification here and check the box Show Only In Scope Items. As you can see now, only the targetapplication.site object is displayed. Note that the In Scope option is available for almost all the tools in Burp. Indeed, if we go back into the proxy option, we can configure it to intercept only the requests and the responses in the target scope by simply checking the rule here. Now, if we enable the intercept once again and try to browse any other website outside of the defined scope, the intercept will simply ignore it. Indeed, as we can see, the eLearn security website loads correctly, and Burp doesn't ask us to perform any operation on requests and responses. While if we request any URL in the scope, Burp intercepts it. Now that everything is set, we can start inspecting our web application and let Burp gather information. Let's go back into our web browser and log into the web app. Let's open a few pages and then go back into the Burp site map to see what's changed. Here we are. We can see that the tree gets populated again with our requests. Note that the bold objects are resources that we have directly requested, while gray objects are resources automatically gathered by Burp. Here, for example, we can inspect the login.php page and the parameters sent, such as the username and the password of the form. In the right panel, we can inspect this request to get more information. For example, we can see the target host, the method used to send these parameters, the resource requests, and much more. Right below this panel, we can inspect the request and the respective response. Note that we can select to display it in different ways. We can inspect the raw request, the parameter sent, the headers, or even the hex format of the request. Right now, we know that by navigating to the target website, the sitemap gets populated. While manually inspecting each page is a good option, we can also tell Burp Suite to automatically crawl the target in order to find all the pages on the website. To do so, we can move on the Spider tab and start configuring it. Here we can see that right now. The spider is paused. Before starting it, let's move into Options and see what we can configure. Here there are a lot of options we can set, such as check the robots.txt in order to find possible URLs or set the link depth for the crawler. One of the things we want to set is how Burp Suite must handle the form submission. In other words, what to do if the crawler finds a form. Here we can see that the default option is to automatically submit the form and use the following rules to set the parameters of the form itself. Since we do not want the crawler to automatically fill the target web application with junk data, let's select the option Prompt for Guidance. For now, let's leave the other settings unchanged and start the spider by clicking on Spider is Paused. Also, be sure that the scope option is set to Use Suite Scope. As you can see, it starts requesting the pages. Indeed, we can see that it has already performed almost 300 requests on the target application. Moreover, it seems that the crawler found a form, and it is asking us to type the data to send. Here we can choose the value of the parameters, or simply ignore the form. For now, let us insert the credentials typed before and confirm. It seems that Burp found another form. Let's ignore it by clicking on Ignore Form. So it seems the spider is done. We can still leave it enabled so it keeps running in the background anytime we visit a new URL in our scope. Let's now go back into the sitemap and see what happened. Here again, the sitemap has been populated with other links and folders, so we now have a better overview of the web app and we can start to manually inspect the target web application. The last tool we want to use today is the repeater. As we already said, it allows us to manually manipulate and reissue HTTP requests in order to analyze the application's responses. For example, let us suppose we want to try different combinations of usernames and passwords, but we don't want to perform this step into the browser, which will be tedious and much slower. We can simply right-click on the login page here and select the Send to Repeater option. Here, we can see the request we are going to send and the username and password parameters. We know these credentials work. If we send the request by clicking on Go and then Follow, the web application redirects a few times. We can see the admin area in the response. Let's see what happens if we type a wrong username or password. So let's go back into the first request and change the username and the password. As you can see now, if we follow the redirect, the login page appears. This, of course, happens because the credentials are wrong and the web application redirects us to the main page. So if we want to quickly test some parameters, we can use the repeater to check how the application behaves. And this concludes our video on Burp Suite. Thank you very much for joining us.